Welcome to the Real News Network. I'm Dharna Noor, coming to you from Baltimore. Firefighters finally gained ground on the deadliest wildfires in California history on Sunday. The wind eased up while searchers combed charred ruins for more victims of the blazes that have claimed at least 40 lives. Another 75,000 have been displaced. More than 5,700 structures have been destroyed by more than a dozen wildfires, which ignited about a week ago and have consumed an area larger than New York City. The city of Santa Rosa lost entire neighborhoods. What's getting far less attention in the media is the evidence linking the historically catastrophic wildfires to the effects of human-induced climate change. With us to discuss this and how we might prevent more wildfires in the future, we're joined by two expert guests. We have John Abatzoglou, who's an associate professor at the Department of Geography at the University of Idaho. And we're also joined by Dr. LeRoy Westerling, who's an associate professor of management at UC Merced and the co-director of the Center for Climate Communication. Thanks to both of you again for joining us. So the 40 confirmed fatalities make these fires in California the deadliest since record-keeping began. It surpasses the 29 deaths from the Griffith Park fire in 1933 in Los Angeles. How do we know that human-caused climate change has contributed to these horrific events? What are the so-called fingerprints of climate change that scientists are identifying? Let's start with you, Professor Abatzoglou. I understand that in one of your studies, you found that human-caused climate change nearly doubled the amount of area taken by forest fires between the mid-80s and 2015.
Yeah, so I think that the way to think about this is we go back to sort of the ingredients you need for sort of having a campfire. And those ingredients are fairly simple. There's three of them. You need to have enough fuel. You need that fuel to be dry enough. And then you need an ignition source. And if we're thinking about our forested regions across the western United States, as well as other areas globally, usually there's enough fuel there. But usually what limits fires, especially large fire seasons, is that the moisture is typically wet enough. And so things that end up altering or reducing the vegetation in fuel, whether that's a recession in mountain snowpack, warmer summer temperatures that draw more moisture out of the fuels, those things can begin to allow forests that used to be sort of more resilient to fire to become fire prone. And we have seen a substantial warming in temperatures. We've seen the fingerprints of losses in mountain snowpack. And collectively, these things have increased fuel dryness in the summertime. And there is a pretty strong link between the amount of area that burns in our forests, particularly at mid to higher elevations, and warm and dry summers. And so in our study, we found that basically of those three ingredients, man-made climate change was acting to increase fuel dryness, creating basically a longer window of the year when fuels could be receptive to igniting and carrying fire.
And Professor Westerling, your research has also shown that wildfires have risen. It's shown that they've risen by over 500% on public land since the late 1970s. Is this increase in wildfires tied to the effect of climate change as well?
Actually, so if you're looking at the most recent decade, it's over a 1,200% increase since the 1970s.
Wow.
In the area burned in federal forests around the western United States. And it's most strongly linked to changes in the timing of spring and warmer temperatures. We have a really diverse set of ecosystems across the western United States, and even within forest areas, and they have different sensitivities to increasing temperatures and changes in the timing of spring. And the places that have shown the largest increases linked to those changes in spring timing and warmer temperatures are places where the forests have been pretty cool and wet historically. And the warming that we've experienced decades and enough to kind of kick them up into a different regime where they can burn more often because of the fire season. The dry season in the summer gets longer when you melt the snow out earlier and you have more evaporation driving fuel aridity that can increase fire.
Dr. Westerling, are there other effects other than climate change, such as deforestation or fire suppression, that's creating the conditions for more extreme fire events?
Yeah, so what's really been compounding the risk or the vulnerability to climate change has been the increase in fuels in forests or in parts of the West due to fire suppression and land use changes. There's been some of that all around the West at different elevations depending on the system. But some of the areas that have been most affected in the Southwest and to just a little bit lesser extent, California, say the mid-elevation Sierra Nevada forests. And if you think about it, historically, or prehistorically, I should say, these might have been really open canopy forests where the fire very often would be down at the surface, burning grass, shrub, and worm and things like that. And not as much in the canopy of the forest because of the spacing between the trees. And fire suppression allowed those forests to grow much more densely. In California, Sierra Nevadas, in Southwest and some other parts of the West. And that has actually made it more vulnerable to climate change because as you warm those forests up and evaporate more moisture every year, you're creating sort of competition for moisture between the individual trees and the drought effects are more severe on them. And when you get fire, now it's burning through the canopy instead of the surface.
We just saw that NASA posted satellite images of the California wildfires as seen from space. Let's take a look at those. So are there any concerns about wildfires being a contributor to climate change from all the burning carbon? And could this set up a sort of feedback loop which would lead to higher temperatures and therefore more disasters? Let's start with you, John.
So wildfires are part of the Earth system, and fire is a natural process that we have to remember when talking about this. But at the same time, when we see these fires burn, they're burning above ground carbon, and a lot of that is getting back up into the atmosphere and contributing to the atmospheric carbon burden. To some effect, these forests do recover, and as they recover, they can, you know, take up carbon dioxide, etc. How those things actually play out through time is yet to be determined. We have seen a substantial increase in fire activity across the West, across much of Canada and Alaska, and we've seen, you know, a lot of carbon coming off of these landscapes. I think that LeRoy has done some work on this, particularly with the carbon perspectives. He might have a better take on it.
Dr. Westerling, would you like to weigh in?
Yeah, with my colleague Matt Hurtow and a student of his, Shuang Liang, we've been looking at integrating statistical models that I do of how fire changes in response to the changes in climate with ecosystem modeling. And the interesting thing that we saw is that as you warm things up and you increase the frequency of large fires in the Sierra Nevada, you get shifts over time where more and more of the forest becomes a source of carbon, a net source of carbon to the atmosphere instead of a net sink. So in recent past, these forests have been a net sink. They've been growing faster than they've been and taking up carbon faster than they've been releasing it. But as you warm things up and increase the pace of fire, they start shifting. So some parts get deforested and other parts are just younger forests and they don't get a chance to replace the lost carbon before they are affected by disturbance in them. But we had to actually run the models out about 500 years to really see the form. There's a real lag between changing climate now and when the ecosystems fully respond into the future. And so really the biggest in carbon, we're not in the 21st century in this modeling, but in the 22nd century.
Okay, Dr. Abatzoglou and Dr. Westerling, please just stick around for part two, and we'll continue to discuss these devastating forest fires in California. Thanks so much for joining us. And thank you for joining us on The Real News Network. Stick around for part two. Mm-hmm.